Good evening, everyone. We'll start tonight's planning committee meeting. We were just waiting to make sure that the audio-visual worked in the Memorial Hall because we do have more people attending tonight than this room will allow. And what we'll try to do later on in the evening, if there are people in Memorial Hall who wish to speak, I will bring that up at the appropriate time. So this is the regular meeting of the Planning Committee of the City of Kingston. I'm Liz Schell, the Chair of the Planning Committee. Councillor Neal is the Vice Chair, and we have Councillor McLaren, Councillor Osanek, Councillor Allen, and Councillor Turner. We have a full slate of councillors tonight, and we have a number of city staff. I see we have Director McClatchy, Commissioner Hurdle, and Manager Vendetti. And I'll start on this side, Manager Newman, Planner Adams, Planner Sands, Manager Forfar, and I see our Director of Legal Services is here, Ms. Nicholson, and our Chief Clerk, Mr. Bolognone, is here this evening as well, and Ms. Blumenberg, who is a fabulous right-hand man clerk. Now, any planning committee meeting, especially with many of the public meetings, there are some statutory requirements, and I'm going to read the public meeting introduction for you to explain what the proceedings will be like this evening. Personal information collected as a result of this public hearing and on the forms provided at the back of the room is collected under the authority of the Planning Act and will be used to assist in making a decision on this matter. All names, addresses, opinions, and comments may be collected and may form part of the minutes, which will be available to the public. Questions regarding this collection should be forwarded to the Director of Planning, Building, and Licensing Services. The purpose of public meetings is to present planning applications in a public forum as required by the Planning Act. Following presentations by the applicant, committee members will be afforded an opportunity to ask questions for clarification or further information. The meeting will then be opened to the public for comments and questions. Interested persons are requested to give their name and address for recording in the minutes. There is also a sign-in sheet just outside the door for interested members of the public. No decisions are made at public meetings concerning applications, unless otherwise noted. The public meeting is held to gather public opinion. Exemption to this rule is outlined in Bylaw 2006-75 to delegate various planning approvals to staff and to adopt certain procedures for the processing of planning applications subject to delegated authority. Council has authorized staff to use discretion in determining if an application can be a combined public meeting comprehensive report to expedite the approval process. There are no combined public meeting comprehensive reports this evening. Public meeting reports are provided to inform the public of all relevant information. Information gathered is then referred back to Planning, Building, and Licensing Services staff for the preparation of a comprehensive report and recommendation to Planning Committee. This means that after the meeting tonight, staff will be considering the comments made by the public in their further review of the applications. When this review is completed, a report will be prepared making a recommendation for action to this committee. The recommendation is typically to approve with conditions or to deny. This committee then makes a recommendation on the applications to City Council. City Council has the final say on the applications from the city's perspective. Following council decision, notice will be circulated in accordance with the Planning Act, and anyone with an interest in the matter may file an appeal. Interested persons are advised that if a person or public body does not make oral submissions at a public meeting or make written submissions before the bylaw is passed, the person or public body is not entitled to appeal the decision of council to the Ontario Municipal Board unless, in the opinion of the board, there are reasonable grounds to do so. And I will emphasize that tonight is a time to make oral submissions, but written submissions can be made to planning staff and therefore to council anytime up until the comprehensive report is presented. And now we will have our first public meeting. This is a application for zoning bylaw amendment 358 Victoria Street. And Ms. Cirello is going to present for us.
Proposed zoning bylaw amendment to permit the development of a second residential unit within the existing dwelling and to permit tandem parking. Subject property is 612 square meters in area and is located in the Sunnyside neighborhood on the west side of Victoria Street between Johnson Street and Brock Street. Existing residential development along Victoria Street is single detached dwellings and tended to be mixed of homeownership and rental units. There are two dwelling units and multi-unit dwellings in the subject area, specifically at the corner of Victoria Street and Brock Street and directly west of the subject property on Toronto Street. The zoning bylaw amendment application is to permit a second residential unit at 358 Victoria Street, located in Kingston, which is designated residential A, one and two family dwelling units. Current use is an existing single-story dwelling unit with an unfinished basement. The proposal is to develop the existing basement into a second dwelling unit, including four bedrooms, two bathrooms, a living room, and a kitchen. This application is being reviewed to obtain relief for the lot area, cellar, and parking design provisions. The subject property is permitted for uses of one and two family dwelling conversions. No relief is required. The lot area requirements are 370 square meters per unit for a total of 740 square meters. Proposed existing is 612 square meters. Relief of 128 square meters is required. The use of a cellar as a dwelling unit is prohibited. Relief required for a cellar as a dwelling unit to be permitted. Adequate driveways and aisles for the removal of vehicles without the necessity of moving any other vehicle. Relief required for the proposed tandem parking. The proposed second dwelling unit will include four bedrooms, two bathrooms, living room, and kitchen within the unfinished basement or cellar. Access to the existing unit will remain unchanged. Access to the second unit will be provided at the rear of the building via existing separate entrance. The entrance to the second unit can be accessed via the existing driveway slash pathway along the north side of the dwelling unit. A proposed canopy and extra lighting will be added to the cover to cover the existing exterior second unit stairs at the request of the city planner. The remainder of the exterior of the building will remain without change. Two parking spaces are proposed on site, one per unit. One parking space will be provided in the existing garage. The second parking space will be provided in a tandem arrangement within the existing driveway in the north side yard. A combined walkway slash driveway with a width of 3.7 meters along the northern property line will provide access to the parking for both units and access to the entrance of the rear unit. Although it is recognized that the city prefers vehicle and pedestrian traffic to be separated, the nature of the development is consistent with the suburban development where site users use their driveway not only for vehicular traffic, but also for pedestrian access. Vehicle traffic on site is anticipated to be low due to the nature of the use, so there will be minimal conflict for the site users. With respect to the request relief from the required minimum lot area of 740 square meters, the proposed reduction of 128 square meters for a lot area of 612 square meters is not anticipated to adversely affect the functionality of the lot. The site can accommodate ample amenity space for users of the site to enjoy, and appropriate parking can be provided. In addition, the proposed relief is not expected to present an appearance of overdevelopment on the lot, given that the exterior appearance will not be altered. The Ontario Building Code does not restrict against dwelling units and lower level units, which would be defined as cellar in the zoning bylaw number 8499. Accordingly, the restrictions prohibiting habitational space within a cellar have been removed from zoning bylaws 76-26, 32-74, and 97-102. However, the restriction has not been removed from the zoning bylaw 8499, which applies to this subject site. The proposed second residential unit will meet the requirements of the OBC and will provide adequate living space and satisfy health and safety measures. Relief from the parking space design standards of the bylaw is requested to permit stacked or tandem parking. The bylaw requires that two parking spaces be provided, one per unit. The provision of the required two spaces in a tandem formation will permit an existing landscape and will permit the existing landscaping to remain and reduce the need for additional paving within the rear yard. The functionality of the vehicular traffic generated by the two-unit dwelling is not anticipated to negatively impact the tandem parking arrangement. Considering the subject property's close proximity to numerous amenities, services, and parks, the compatibility and consistency of the proposed addition with the existing development in the areas, we are the opinion that the relief requested for zoning bylaw number 8499 is appropriate and conforms to the policies of the official plan.
Thank you very much. Could I hear from staff, please?
Through you, Madam Chair. Notice was given as per the requirements of the Planning Act. And there's been one piece of public correspondence which was received and has been attached as part of the agenda tonight.
Thank you. Questions from the committee? Councillor Neal?
Yes, I have a couple of questions. With the existing unit being 5-bedroom and 4 bedrooms being proposed below, that equals 9 bedrooms, and given the nature of the rental, that's probably going to be 9 adults. I have some questions and some concerns about only 2 parking spaces there, because I think that that will be inadequate given the nature of the rental units. Is there any assurance from either through lease or whatever that once your 2 parking spaces are taken up, that that residents won't by right be able to expect a parking space?
I can speak to the owner about that, but I know that the upper unit right now is all rented and no one has a vehicle within the 5 bedrooms.
Thank you. I know that that's not always the case with student rentals. My other question regards, I know that we had a great debate in the last council about basement apartments versus cellar apartments. I'd just like some assurance from our staff that the ceiling heights will be adequate in the cellar dwelling. And also, I'm a little concerned because I always thought that dwellings needed 2 exits in the event of a fire. And all that I can see from the drawings here are a lot of narrow windows that I definitely couldn't crawl through, and only 1 entrance. If staff can address that, or if the planner can address that.
Mr. Sands?
Certainly, through you, Madam Chair. With respect to that, staff will be reviewing the application through the technical review process in conjunction with the Building Department. The Building Department will ensure that the proposed development meets the Ontario Building Code.
Thank you. I look forward to that. My other question, and staff can correct me if I'm wrong, they've been known to do it before. It says 43% of existing structure. Am I right? Is my recall right that secondary suites are limited and are supposed to be 40% or less? Is within the secondary suite policy?
Mr. Sands?
Through you, Madam Chair, you are correct. Secondary suites, by definition, are to contain a maximum of 40% of the total gross floor area of the dwelling, and or a maximum of 90 square meters, whichever is the lesser. As this application, I believe, is 137 square meters in size and 43% of the total gross floor area, that would mean that this unit is defined as a second dwelling unit as opposed to a secondary suite. Thank you.
I'll talk to you. So I think I've got to get my head around that, and I need more of an explanation. So I'll speak to the planners later about when is a secondary suite not a secondary suite. Thank you.
Sir.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Through you, I have a question about the entrance to the cellar, which is that top right-hand picture. up there. And I just wondered if you could describe that more. Like, when you actually do finish the basement with those four bedrooms, will you be widening that? Like, it just looks really steep. And considering the humongous amount of snow we just got this week, I would just envision that would all be covered in snow. So I just wondered if you could describe that entrance.
Yeah, the width of the entrance does meet code, but we are adding a canopy, and we're going to add a guard along the side to prevent any snow from going into, like, down into the stairs. Of course, they'll still be open to access, so you will get some, but it'll need to be cleaned up.
Okay, thanks very much. I also have a question about bikes and garbage. So I think I read in the report that that garage that we see in the bottom left-hand picture is going to be one of the parking spots, or is that where bikes and garbage would go? I know that's a site plan question, but having 9 potential adults in the house, that's one of the concerns I have.
Yeah, that will be used. There's actually a shed in the back behind the garage as well that can be used for that storage.
My last question is just the hot water tank. Is it one tank and that's in the cellar for the entire house? Like, again, just with so many people in the house, would there be enough hot water?
We're actually separating everything. So the furnace will be relocated. The hot water will be relocated upstairs, and a new hot water tank will be added. And the electrical panels will be separated, moved upstairs for the unit, and a new electrical panel being added downstairs.
Councillor McLaren.
Thank you. I heard you say that the health and safety had been taken care of. I'm just wondering about the tailpipe from that car and the window so nearby in what looks like a valley between two houses. Are there any mitigating techniques that have been used to make sure nobody gets poisoned by carbon monoxide from tailpipes?
That hasn't looked at, but I can look at that and get back to you in the next meeting.
Seeing no other questions from the committee, I would like to invite the public to make comments or ask questions. We have two microphones, one on this side and one over on this side. And the way we do this is you have 5 minutes to speak, and all comments will be added together, and the proponent will be asked to reply to all of the comments at the end. Is there anyone who wishes to speak or comment on this application? Seeing none, I'll give the committee one more chance. And I'd like to thank you very much for your presentation. And that closes the public meeting for 358 Victoria Street. Our next public meeting is Zoning Bylaw Amendment 462 Barry Street. Applicant Anne Marie Lee will be presenting.
Okay, hi everyone. I'm Anne Marie Lee. I'm the owner at 462 Barry Street. I'm here just to chat with you really quickly about an application I've made for a zoning bylaw amendment at this rental property. So this is a picture here of what the building looks like now. And actually the building isn't going to be changing at all from the outside. Just some cosmetic upgrades, but the overall building footprint wouldn't be changing at all. We will be updating the front porch and removing some awnings off of the back of the building, but the footprint won't change at all. So basically the whole plan is just to change the interior a little bit. So currently it's a duplex. There's a 4-bedroom unit in the front here. And in the back, there's a nice loft-style 1-bedroom apartment. So what I'm proposing to do is to change the front 4-bedroom unit into 2 1-bedroom units. So basically change the overall layout from 2 units to 3 units. Right now, how it's laid out is we have awesome tenants in the back 1-bedroom unit. We always get fabulous tenants who take great care of the building. But what I found is that in the front unit, we tend to have fairly rowdy undergrad students there. That's what you get with a 4-bedroom rental in this area. I have a growing young family, and I don't really want to deal with the noise and the extra garbage anymore. So I've decided I'd really like to invest some money into this property. I love the neighborhood, and I'd like to change it into 3 executive-style 1-bedroom units. So we're going to decrease the overall bedrooms from the current 5 bedrooms to 3 bedrooms overall, install bicycle parking, and there will be 2 parking spaces provided. So usually it's required that you have to have 1 parking space per unit. The reason why 2 parking spaces would work really well for this application is because, first of all, you're going to have fewer tenants. So right now I have 5 tenants, be going down to 3. Currently with the 5 tenants, I do only have 2 parking spaces, and it's working out really well. So I'm sure that when we go down to 3 tenants, it will be fine to have just the 2 parking spaces. Also, the area is really well serviced by transit. You just walk out the front door and there's a bus stop right there. There's also an express bus route just around the corner. I will be installing bicycle parking. As you can see in the site plan here, there's a covered overhang where we'll have 3 bicycle parking spaces. There's quite a bit of amenity area. And also, there have been parking studies done recently in the downtown and Williamsville area that have indicated that you actually really only need parking for 50% of the units in this area, and we will be providing more than that. So I hope you can see this okay. I just wanted to show you quickly what the change to the layout of the unit will be. So currently, as you can see on the main floor, you walk in, there's a living room, a bedroom, a small little two-piece bathroom, and quite a large kitchen at the back. The proposed plan is to walk in the front door, and right there you'll have access to 2 doors. One will take you upstairs to the upstairs one-bedroom unit. The other one will lead you right into the downstairs one-bedroom unit. So you'd walk in and have your living room, bedroom right there. The bathroom will be completely gutted. I'm installing brand new fixtures into a nice large 4-piece bathroom. And then in the kitchen, we're going to be installing a brand new kitchen with stainless steel appliances, granite countertops. As I said, this will be a top-of-the-line executive-style apartment to help attract really great tenants to the area. So this is the second floor. So as you go upstairs, as you can see right now, there's a 4-piece bathroom and 3 bedrooms, perfect for, you know, your regular student rental. But what I would really like to do is gut that bathroom, make it a really nice bathroom, get rid of the walls around 2 of the bedrooms. So you'd have a really nice galley kitchen there. Again, granite countertops, stainless steel appliances, a nice kitchen island, and then you'll have the bedroom there. And I guess, again, as I said earlier, there is a back loft-style one-bedroom unit that will remain unchanged. So in conclusion, my application is to provide just better tenants for the area, less noise, less garbage overall. There'll be quieter and fewer tenants. And really, I just would like to make an investment in the neighborhood. I love the area. I'm willing to invest some money to, just have some nicer units and better neighbors for everyone in the area. That's it.
Thank you very much. And could I hear from staff, please?
Yes, through you, Madam Chair. Notice was given as per the requirements of the Planning Act. And additionally, one piece of public correspondence has been received to date, which has been included as part of the agenda.
Thank you very much. Questions from the committee? Councillor Neal?
Just a quick comment. I know Queen's did a fairly extensive study looking at what students prefer, and it definitely is smaller number of bedrooms and better quality dwellings. And given the amount that they pay for lodging for apartments, I applaud your project. I think it's sensible. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. And now I'd like to open the floor to the public. If there are any members of the public who have comments or questions about this application. Seeing none, I will close this public meeting, and thank you very much for your presentation.
Thank you.
That closes 462 Berry Street. And we have another public meeting, application for zoning bylaw amendment 169 Union Street. And I believe Mr. Keene will be presenting. Hi.
Well, good evening, everyone. Good evening, Madam Chair, members of the Planning Committee, staff, and the public. My name is Mike Keene, and I am a land use planner with FOTEN Consultants. and I'm here this evening to present to you an application for zoning bylaw amendment at 169 University Street. So this property is located right on the door of Queen's University, and you can see from the rings, it's quite a central site with respect to its location to institutions and the downtown business district. And it's more well known as the former Queen's daycare facility that operated for approximately 40 years of time. The site itself is 1,800 meters, which translates into roughly a half an acre in size. There is slightly more than 40 meters of frontage on both Union Street and Albert Street. And as you can see from the photo, the building is more or less centrally located. Moving in a little closer, a more familiar picture taken in the fall, so you can see through the fence and the hedging. The building is actually has a heritage easement on it that allows the building to be protected, all of its character features, windows and other items that are involved in that regard. But in 2014, it was determined, and it might be off on the year, it might have been before 2014, but the renovations that were needed to maintain this as a daycare were cost prohibitive. So the property went on the market, and my client, who is a dentist, has purchased the property. And so his proposal is to convert the main floor to be a dental office for himself, and the second and third floor would be converted back to residential. So in terms of the existing situation right now, it's a three-story building that will obviously remain as such. And the entire building was used as daycare facilities. It's currently vacant, pending an application that is before you this evening. And those other elements like heritage easements are what are going to protect the building in terms of what you see today will remain. And parking, which is kind of loosely been off of Albert Street, and it kind of extends into the municipal right-of-way. These are some things that will get cleaned up through this application. So the proposal that's before the committee this evening would be to permit a dental clinic on the first floor, and it's also to provide for neighborhood commercial uses, and then it would be to permit a total of three residential units between the second and third floor, largely just rearranging the parking to formalize it a little more to provide for 14 parking spaces. So that would be one space for each of the apartment units, and 11 spaces for the dental clinic to cover staff at the clinic as well as patients. And my note says 800 meters of amenity space in the rear. I mean, it depends on how you look at it. The point is that it's got a lot of land available for amenity, kind of in the front and wrapping around the one side. With the building being centrally located, the setbacks of this building are much larger than I'm used to working with, to be quite honest. And the proposal is not to change the exterior of the building. However, I'll add one caveat, and that is that the building is not currently accessible. And so through the site plan control process and any necessary heritage permits, we would likely improve the front entrance in some fashion so that the front entrance, which is the Union Street entrance, would become accessible. Rather than having patients come through the back door if they had accessible needs. So I'll just show you the layout. So in terms of the site plan, you can see the arrangement is largely remaining the same with parking on Albert Street. You can see how we would be limiting the access to a single access right at the back of the property. And there would be, the three residential parking spaces off to the side. Amenity area is largely down this side yard and the front yard, which would be a mix of amenity and common space for people at the clinic. And then you'd have your clinic parking per se, or sufficient parking if another use moved in there in the future. So looking at the layout inside, oops, sorry, I clicked too fast. The right side of the photo is the reception area. The central area of the building is really like the corridor where the bathrooms and the lab and the storage area would be. And then the left side of the building would have a staff area at the back of the building. And then it would have four rooms that would be for patients for dental work. The second floor has two units, and the building's kind of uniquely stepped. So the second floor would have a one-bedroom unit that has its kitchen living area at the back of the building, and then it would have one bedroom kind of centrally located at the front. And then the front unit on the second floor has two bedrooms with the kitchen common area on the left. And then the other picture is the top floor, which is within the mansard roof, and it would be a two-bedroom unit. So the proposal is two-bedroom units and a one-bedroom unit. In terms of the official plan, this is within an area that's designated residential. There are residential designation permits neighborhood commercial uses. The key is controlling the scale of those uses. The official plan also speaks about residential intensification and infill. And in this case, we're talking obviously pretty minor infill, particularly because we are reusing an existing building. And obviously it's a building that is in good proximity to many amenities, many employment areas, and of course the university being both an employment area and student area. And many of the urban design criteria has been looked at in terms of how we've rearranged the site and how we would intend to make additional changes to improve things such as accessibility. So with respect to the zoning bylaw, the current zoning is the A zoning, which is one and two family dwelling. And the daycare that has existed there for a long time, it was my understanding that it would be a legal non-conforming use. Our proposal would be to amend the zoning bylaw to a site-specific neighborhood commercial zone, which would have two effects. It would limit the types and the scale of the commercial uses that would be permitted on the site. So for example, if you had a professional use this space, such as a dentist or engineer or any of these types, real estate agent, you'd be limited to a single practitioner. So that helps control the scale so that it is neighborhood specific and it doesn't overrun the facility. And that's really the key aspect of this zoning bylaw, was tying down those uses to ensure their neighborhood and tying down the scale of such that they would be appropriate. And as this committee will know, I often ask for a reduction in the size of the parking stall. And as such, I've asked for the reduction here, which is a 10 centimeter reduction, so the width of your hand, and they would become 80 centimeters shorter. And in this context, being single row parking, I believe it would be appropriate to do that. It allows us to really what I wanted to do was maintain the front yard the way it is today and the side yard. I'm trying to aside from maintaining the building, we are also trying to maintain the landscape as much as possible just because it's been there for such a long time. So in summary, I say no exterior changes, but in actual fact, I can assure you that my client intends to clean up the building and make it look a little nicer and bring it back into good repair. So no changes by the form of extra windows or extra floors, but certainly improvements are planned for the site and an accessible access to that front door. It's my opinion the proposal represents good land use planning and is consistent with the city's planning documents. And we've done what we believe is appropriate to ensure the development is scaled in the event that another small-scale commercial use would like to move onto the site in the future. And I'm pleased to respond to any questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And could I hear from staff, please?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Notice was provided in accordance with the Planning Act to date, and no correspondence has been received as of yet.
Thank you. Questions from the committee? Councillor Neal?
Yes, I'm really glad the commitment that seems to be getting made to the heritage aspects of the building. I'm a little curious, and I know parking ultimately is addressed as site plan. My concern is how many employees will need parking spaces. I appreciate that there are three units and three parking spaces for the residential, but that's a question I think that will need to be addressed, that indeed if the, you said 14 parking spaces, three of them are residential, so 11 would be for the first floor commercial.
Yes.
Okay, I applaud the fact that I live not far from this neighborhood, and it's great that there's going to be a dentist in the vicinity, and so I applaud that, and in principle, I think it's a good proposal. But I'm concerned, A, about the landscaping, how can we make that corner look better through site plan, and B, adequate parking. Thank you.
Well, if I may respond to that, Madam Chair, we're not applying to amend the number of spaces that are required. So we are actually meeting the zoning bylaws requirements. I would be my opinion, we probably could have done a parking study to actually reduce a few spaces, but because of the arrangement of the site, we didn't need to, and we weren't really moving into that front or side yard. So we felt that there were some of those improvements that you're talking about are certainly going to happen just because the new owner is going to want to trim bushes, plant new bushes, whatever the case might be, remove fences. I think that right away is going to be the biggest change because you're going to have a formalized site plan. So you're actually going to see your municipal median restored, I would suggest. So everything will be tied down.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Councillor Osen.
Thank you, Madam Chair. My question or my concern with this is that you have 10 trees and you're going to be removing three or four trees to accommodate the parking area. Do you have a picture up there to kind of show which trees we're talking about? In our report, it's page 5, and it looks like there's a really large one on Albert Street, and I'm hoping that's not one of the three to four trees that might be removed. If it was like the cedar tree, that would be okay, or if there's like smaller trees, so I just wondered.
No, I most certainly appreciate your concern, and you know, I recognize this is a concern of both staff and this committee, and so when we were designing the parking space and the layout, we were very conscious of the trees, and so I'm not positive, but I believe the tree that you're referring to is this tree, and it would be retained. So it's kind of hard to see on the screen, but there is a tree that would be, it's approximately where I'm circling on the screen, that would be subject to removal. And there were also a few trees that were kind of across the back that were close to the line. But I don't know exactly. We've done our inventory, but we would have to do our preservation plan through site plan. So.
Okay, thank you. So in the report, it's that tree. Anyway, just like when, as you work more with staff through it, that one looks large. Of course, this is taken in winter time. Maybe it's an ash tree for all I know. I don't know, and I don't have the Arbor Care report in front of me or anything, but
Is that page 5 of my report?
Yeah, yeah.
That tree, the largest tree there, is being retained.
Okay, perfect. Yes. Okay, well, that's my concern. Thank you very much.
Any other questions from the committee? Councillor Turner.
Thank you, and through you, Madam Chair. Thanks for your presentation. But what I'd like to know, following up to your question about the trees, will you be planting any more trees?
We haven't.
Have you got a new landscape plan?
We haven't proceeded with the site plan application yet.
Okay.
So we haven't hired a landscape architect yet. It's one of those items that I could suggest that additional trees be planted to my client. So, I mean, our goal is to maintain the look as much as possible, and I believe as such, that's trees. You know, there are some beautiful trees in that area, so I can make that suggestion. And also, like, in terms of when we cut down trees, the city's guidelines require replacement. So if we cut down a large tree, the options are multiple trees to equal that large tree or a pretty substantial cost payment. So in the event that any substantial trees are removed, I generally find it's of benefit to the owner to plant trees rather than pay the cost. But in some cases where there's, let's say, less land available, cost might be the only option. In this case, those trees would, I believe the owner would replace them. That would certainly be my advice to him.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. Seeing no further questions, I will open this public meeting to members of the public. Mr. Dixon, if you'd like to come to the microphone, please. And again, 5 minutes per person, and we will answer all questions at the end. Ask the proponent to answer at the end. And name and address, please.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chair. Frank Dixon, 495 Alfred, Apartment 2, K7K4J4. Madam Chair, members of the committee, city staff, media, and Kingstonians, I think it's a very smart business plan. Dental clinic in that location would be excellent service for the Queen's University campus. So I'm in favor of that very much. A couple of questions I have. The amenity space that you have described, is that going to be shared among the new residential tenants as well as the business operating there? And number two is, given that there's new residential plan for the second and third floors, whereas before there had been daycare there for many years, has there been thought given to fire escape provisions? Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any other comments or questions from the public? If you'd like to answer that, Mr. Keane.
Through you, Madam Chair, to respond to the two questions. I think the amenity space, our requirements are to the tune of 50 square meters. We have 800. So if staff saw fit to divide an area that was entirely private, we have the ability to do that. It was our intent to kind of leave the site open as it is. So to respond to your question, the current layout is, it's wide open. It would be both the dental clinic and the three units that would have access to that space. And with respect to fire, like a fire stair, the units all have to have two ways in and out. And so those are code matters that I don't want to misspeak about, because I can't recall if we were actually going to have the two stairs on the inside. I believe that there is actually a fire stair there that might have to be upgraded slightly for those upper floors. But all three units would have to have code required double entrance. So the second floor, that might be a case of a large window. But certainly the third floor would have to have, I believe, at least a stair down to that second floor. So I don't know the specific detail, but it's a code matter that will have to be addressed. And, I mean, if a stair had to be added, that might be a matter that would require a heritage approval if it was beyond, we're even thinking that possibly the front entrance that requires the accessible entrance, I would assume we'll have to get a heritage permit for that. So.
Great, thank you very much. Any other questions from the committee? I will now close this public meeting, and thank you very much, Mr. Keane. And our next public meeting is application for official plan of amendment and zoning bylaw amendment 5157 Queen, 18 Queen, and 282 Ontario Street. I believe Mr. Brandt and Mr. Toe will be presenting this application.
Thank you, Madam Chair and members of Planning Committee, and thank you also to members of the public for your time and for coming out tonight. So my name is Mark Tao. I'm a professional planner with IBI Group here in Kingston. Presenting with me tonight is Mr. Rod Leahy, who's a project architect and principal at Roderick Leahy Architects. Incorporated also is Mark Brandt, the senior conservation architect and urbanist at MTBA Architects. Both of these gentlemen have done work in Kingston and are familiar with the area, as am I, obviously, as this is my home for the past number of years. So the application that we're presenting tonight are two applications, for official plan amendment and for zoning bylaw amendment. In support of development of Block 3 and Block 5 in the North Block area in downtown Kingston. And the proposal is for high-density residential development and also ground floor commercial uses and also, in addition, public parking garage. So the location of the site, as you can see in the slide, is just immediately north of Lower Princess Street corridor and City Hall. So the North Block area outlined in black dotted lines consists of 4.5 city blocks. The subject property is the south half of Block 3 and Block 5, which is half of this block here. It doesn't extend all the way through to Princess Street. Particulars of the two blocks specifically, Block 3, the southern half, is just over 4,000 square meters. The north half is currently occupied by two existing buildings. The Block 5 parcel is almost 4,000 square meters, and it is occupied currently by a parking lot, surface parking lot. And immediately to the south of that is a couple of commercial developments, including the SNR building. So the images here, you'll see on the screen, Block 1 is currently occupied by the Food Basics grocery store and associated surface parking. Block 2 is the K-Rock Center. Block 3 is Good Life Fitness building, which also houses a couple of other tenants beyond Good Life, and also the LCBO building here in the bottom left-hand corner. Block 4 is currently used for a hydro building and also surface parking. It's a former City of Kingston police station site. The remainder of the site beyond the hydro building is currently used for surface parking. And Block 5 also, in addition to the current surface parking use, the south half is currently home to the SNR building as well as a number of smaller commercial buildings on the west half of that block. With respect to the broader context in the downtown, you'll see in the image here, the two subject sites are located here in red. The Lower Princess Street core area, including City Hall and Confederation Basin, are shown in yellow. The south half of the waterfront is characterized by a number of larger developments, typically high-density residential. The north half of the waterfront on the north of downtown and north of City Hall is characterized by a mix of uses. The North Block area is a major part of this area. And currently, as you saw in the slides previous, there are a number of underutilized sites. This subject sites in particular have been surface parking for a number of years, and the applications are proposing to seek to develop the northern portion of the downtown north of City Hall and Market Square area in a manner similar to the south half, i.e. Redeveloping lands that were previously used for industrial purposes and have been for a number of years undeveloped or underutilized, often due to restrictions or prohibitions from contamination. So on the picture on the south of the south waterfront, you'll see in the top part of that picture the Sydenham Ward area, which is a heritage conservation district. Along the waterfront, it's typified by a number of taller buildings that have been built both recently and also over a number of decades. As we were going through our analysis in support of this project, we looked closely at the number of buildings, the style of buildings, the height of buildings in the downtown area. In total, in the red, yellow, and green areas along the water, there are 22 buildings that are six stories or higher. There are eight buildings that are 10 stories or higher, and there are five buildings that are 15 stories or higher. The north portion has seven buildings, 6 to 9 stories in height, the most recent of which is the Anna Lane development, actually, which is just right about here. And that's 9 stories. So the idea that we have presented as part of our planning rationale is that as the town, or as the city grows, and as the downtown grows and intensifies implementing policies of the official plan and direction of the city, what areas can support this intensification? And it appeared to us, based on these existing conditions, that this north waterfront area is an area that is supportive of intensification due to proximity to centralized services, amenities, transportation, et cetera. So I'll now pass the presentation over to Mr. Leahy, who will go through the details of the building design itself and the details of the proposal.
Good evening, Madam Chair, members of council, planning staff. Thank you very much. These are exciting proposal for us to be able to work on and be part of Kingston. If I could start out with just a quick review of objectives from my client's point of view and my design objectives. And sometimes we come to an agreement and sometimes not. But the development objectives of Homestead was essentially to redevelop the two vacant lots that have been described earlier, to introduce some 380 residential units in downtown Kingston, to provide over 30,000 square feet of office space, to provide a much-needed public parking garage, and through all of the above, to reinforce the existing business community and the overall livability of the city. Now, my design objectives are to provide an opportunity for a more compact form of urban living that will allow for intensification to take place without adversely impacting the current built form. And this is an area of architecture that I've spent most of my life actually working toward. And examples are in Ottawa and the Byward Market, where we've managed to control the development to the periphery of the market and protect the essence of the Byward Market. And actually, through the last really 10 years, I've seen a sort of rebirth of the Byward Market. This is now being done again in an area we're doing a lot of work with in Little Italy in Ottawa, where again, development has been kept to the perimeter of the area to ensure that the existing fabric of that area, which is so unique to Ottawa, is able to maintain and prosper. So the problems when you get into buildings of this size is how do you control the visual impact of that building? And so that's one of the objectives, is actually to to ensure that what we do doesn't adversely impact the heritage resources of the area and the neighborhood. We also want to provide an attractive at-grade environment that supports and encourages a walkable city. And that, again, it's very important. And it's, I believe, a goal you've achieved here in the city and want to keep maintaining. We also want to design this building that speaks to our time, while at the same time responding and being respectful to the past. And also, one of the key features of this particular two sites is we have to design a building that meets the parking objectives in a unique way due to the impact of the existing conditions of the site, in particular the soil conditions and contamination. So to that end, we have a design which I'm going to try to bring forward in a very quick way. I think there's probably too many slides to go through in any meaningful way, but block three, as described on Queen Street between Wellington and King Street, I think what's unique about this, what separates it from the other block, is actually 50% of the site is made up of a public parking garage that will be owned and operated by the City of Kingston. The balance of the site is the proposed high-rise building for approximately 180 residential units. The plans basically are here for information. There's too many to go through, but basically you can see the public parking garage acts totally independent of the rest of the site. Key features of this development as well as the other development is when we look at sites like this and developments like this, we look at it in terms of two or multiple of scales. We look at it in terms of a city scale and its impact on the skyline. We look at it from a neighborhood scale at a street level, and then we look at closer detail as the building evolves. And one of the objectives was to realizing we're dealing with a higher building and it's certain mass, is how do we use architectural techniques to reduce the visual impact of that building on a cityscape point of view. And I think as we get in the urban design portion of this presentation, you'll see which we feel is a successful solution. And we've used techniques such as change in materials and change in plane to do that. The second, probably the most important in both of these, is the use of the podium. And the podium in both cases has been designed to bring the view plane back to the grade level, back to the pedestrian level, the level where we actually all live and work and walk and sort of exist within the city, is within those first five floors or so. It's that impact on the street. So the buildings, both buildings, and we've done a number of views, but express the idea of the podium and the tower on top and the building in block five in the distance. And again, the use of materials, color, to begin reducing it from a city scale, and we go further in the presentation, actually from a more pedestrian, and I think in my opinion, a more important scale, which is at the street level where we actually experience our buildings. Block five is substantially different in its approach. We had to, the desire from Homestead was to relocate head offices to this site and increase their offices to a much larger presence in the city than they currently are. And this gave a great opportunity to do that. This section is basically been given over to office use on the ground floor, and then it picks up again through special elevator system up into the sixth and seventh floor of the tower. Again, residential uses in this case go right down to grade with the exception of amenity spaces and some secondary spaces for the residential sort of accessing the street. As we move up, the building gets continually smaller with amenity spaces on both buildings. Actually, a sort of unique approach, because we stepped the building back after the 16th floor, we We stepped the building back with a roof terrace. The amenity space is the entire floor of that floor with an outdoor roof terrace, taking advantage of views of the city and the lake. What's unique about this proposal, again, is the way we've handled the parking. In this case, the parking has been restricted to a smaller section. We have the office use for the rental activity on the grade, parking within the upper floors of this portion of the site only, and then the offices of the relocated offices of Homestead on the sixth and seventh floor. The building then steps down. The podium is used to step down toward the lower podium of three stories in height as the building slopes down Queen Street toward Ontario. Again, you can see in these slides the idea of the taller podium. In this case, we have the five-story reference line here, and then set back the two floors of office spaces again. So creating a unique sort of corner condition, and then again, the podium stepping down to the three-level podium on the end toward Ontario Street. And again, the use of changing materials to try to reduce the overall visual impact. But I think more importantly, we've done a number of slides to show what this begins to feel like at a streetscape. And the idea of the podium and the strength of the podiums and how you can use color and material to reinforce the lower scale and reflect the nature of the properties across the street and in the area. It's a successful, I think, technique used almost everywhere now in terms of high-rise design, as opposed to the more traditional modernist approach was just to bring the building right down to grade. I think this actually begins to create a reference line that I say that brings you back to the lower scale of the immediate neighborhood. Two very different approaches. On the block five, we've used a sort of gray stone base that reflects sort of the limestone nature of the city. And then on block three, we've actually done a very detailed red brick facade that picks up the sort of rhythm of the street and the more of a reflection of the hydro station across. In both buildings, we've tried to, again, speak to a building that speaks to its past, but speaks to a very modern interpretation of the past. So we use details, heritage details, in a very non-traditional way that sort of bring that liveliness and life to a building. We use, in this case, a series of pilasters and vertical rhythms that picks up the very traditional vertical rhythm of the Ontario streets. And I think we've added a few slides just with some a little bit level more rendering details, showing again how our building sort of, I think, works well to fit into the community. And sort of when we get more into the qualitative aspects of the architecture with detailing, that begins to be brought out with a little bit more crisper rendering. So that's my presentation. Mr. Brandt will continue.
Well, thank you and good evening, everyone. It's my pleasure to be back in this wonderful room again. Our firm was retained to do two components of the overall submission package. One was the heritage impact assessment, which is required as part of the planning process, and the other one was the urban design report, also required under the planning process. Both areas are areas of our firm's specialization and expertise, and we've been in operation for over 30 years working in this area. So let's look at the heritage impact assessment first. The intention of this presentation, my portion of the presentation, is to simply quickly summarize the reports that have already been submitted and are already publicly available. The heritage impact assessment report looks very carefully at the context and especially the designated heritage resources. Those are the key elements that are required to be reviewed with respect to a heritage impact assessment. And these resources are divided into two categories. First category is part four under the Ontario Heritage Act, which are individual properties that are designated. Three of those four images that you see in front of you are in fact designated under part four. And those are upper left, which is 1923 Queen, upper right, which is the hydro building on the same block four as 1923, and the SNR building, which is adjacent to block five. In the bottom left, I just wanted to show you an example of our studies that we did in the surrounding district to look at a number of buildings, and you'll see them in the report. There's about four or five of them that we particularly study and do elevational drawings for, detailed photography for. I picked at random, I picked the Wig building. These buildings that we looked at, we wanted to understand the nature of those buildings in this area, because our recommendation was to use those buildings as inspiration for the design of the podium, and we'll talk a bit more about that in a minute. The other type of designated heritage resources that the heritage impact assessment needs to address are those under Part 5 of the Ontario Heritage Act, which is heritage conservation districts. The closest heritage conservation district to the two sites is the City Hall and Market Square Heritage Conservation District. In our view, it's the only designated under Part 5 that there has an impact. And so we looked at that, and here are two views of that Heritage Conservation District. I think everyone in the room will be very familiar with City Hall.
Managing Director, yes, of the Downtown Kingston BIA.
Thank you.
Thank you for hearing me. My name is Matthew Gaventer, 93 Hillcrest Avenue. I'm not going to talk about the height or many other of the issues that have been raised here. You've heard a lot of eloquent speakers and factual presentations of various sorts, and I really don't think I have a lot to add to that. I have my opinions, but views, but I don't think, what I do want to talk about is affordability. And it was mentioned a few times, but I wanted to be here because I wanted to reemphasize the importance of addressing that issue. I would like the planning committee and to keep a close, work very closely and continually emphasize with the planning department that the official plan targets for affordability should be considered in this development. What hasn't been discussed much, it has been discussed, is who's going to live in these buildings. Now, you know, over the years, I have been an advocate for affordable housing. And when I say affordable housing, I mean more addressing core housing needs. We have the affordability level of 60 percentile leaves out a lot of people, and 60% of the population. And it is not a very useful approach. So I would, over the years in addressing this issue with council, and I addressed it on the Barry Field issue and others, I was repeatedly told that, or there were comments made in reaction to the presentations, that what the city needs is to disperse the people who have need affordable housing throughout the city, that is the proper, most effective way of integrating people. And yet every time we get a chance to do that, we don't seem to do it. And here we have a situation where a developer is saying, we want more height, we want more density, we want more, we don't want to have our commercial, we want certain favors. And the official plan says that we will negotiate with such, these opportunities to negotiate a component of affordable housing in the new development. So I urge you to meet that objective. This has been a promise you and your people who previously sat in your seats. that you would do that, that you would make sure that housing was dispersed. You know, I just finished a book, Democracy in Kingston. I forgot the author, but it was about how Rito, one of the critical part of the book was how Rito Heights got developed. And you know, Rito Heights was not supposed to be developed as one concentration. It was proposed that the housing would be developed in Calvin Park, and I've got the various sites in the city that were supposed to have a dispersal of affordable housing. You know what? Everybody said, not in my backyard, no, no. And it all got centralized in one place. Well, we gotta break that mold. We have to fight that issue, that resist that idea, and we have to make sure that the people living downtown are a mix of all people, and that everybody has an opportunity to share the downtown. So I won't say much more. I don't know if I've been carrying on too far on this, but I do think it's an important component that you need to address. Thank you.
My name is Susanna Cliff-Jüngling, and I live on 28 Alma Street. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak. I know I will have to be brief and will therefore not be able to point out the extensive list of shortcomings and problems I see with the application in front of us. And a lot of those shortcomings have been all very, very eloquently raised. So here are just a few, maybe a bit disjointed comments I will make. So indeed, what kind of city do we want? Do we want a city where developers don't get to play by the rules, where we constantly allow them to break the rules, i.e. get amendments from the official plan and zoning bylaws, and where we then end up with a city that is not at all consistent with the plans we laid out in the first place, that is the official plan? Is coexisting all we want? The caption under figure 28 in the report claims this view illustrates that old and new buildings can coexist. For one, I would argue that this statement is without substance because the two exist in the same place, they coexist, so what? The more important and relevant questions to ask may be, is this desirable? Does it add to our sense of community? Does it enhance the experience people have in the space? And an example, I think, where this maybe has been done fairly successfully is the, I think it's called the Admiralty Place, just on Ontario Street. So does it really add to the character of downtown and make it more livable, more vibrant, all the words we've heard tonight? What is good for developers is not necessarily good for our community. Developers' goal is to make a profit, and councillors have an obligation to residents and the community as a whole, and these are not the same. And there is this, what I will call the compromise game, and I think here's how it is played. You make your application for the highest building you want. Push people so you get what works for you. Then you sell it as a reasonable compromise, even though your side did not really have to compromise at all. Incidentally, the Capital Project is currently advertising to potential buyers that 15 stories are a slam dunk with the city. Are they anticipating a compromise? So here is high, and we've heard this from many people, high rises or higher density. The same urban density can take many forms. So all three scenarios shown here are 75 units per hectare. And so it does show that, while it has been raised by many people, that we can have density and increase our density without building high rises. And I think that is really in front of us today as a question. And we have some good examples in town of densification. I would argue that the row house complex on Victoria Park comes to mind, and we have older ones, such as the small apartment building at the corner of Berry and William Street. And if you don't know what I'm talking about, check it out. And then there is the quote, and it's maybe not, I think it's the quote from the report, play space is not required. This is just an example of the various exemptions beyond height that, as the obvious one, that are asked for in the application. And if the argument is that new people are going to move to downtown, increasing the number of residents, that's what has been the argument, then how can the applicant say that, quote, the influx of residential development is not expected to overwhelm the use of any of these outdoor amenity areas, namely McBurney Park, Market Square, and Artillery Park. How much capacity is there at Artillery Park? How many more dogs can be walked in McBurney Park? Is it acceptable to say that children have to go several blocks up the road to play? What about unstructured play that happens where you live or when you are visiting your grandparents? There is a reason why we ask developers to include these amenities into their designs. Let's not transfer the public developer's responsibility to the public purse. And play spaces can take or can come in many forms. And play is important for mental and physical health. Why is there not more willingness on the developer's side to comply with these rather minor requirements that will benefit the community? The built environment is going to be with us for decades to come. Let us put some thought and creativity into it. Okay, the desire to be a big town. I'm always struck by the apparent lure of the supposed greatness of the big city, the desire to emulate it, to want to play in the big city, in the big league. It looks impressive and maybe desirable to some. But has Toronto solved major problems with these high-rises? The rents are still high, and we heard an argument tonight that it would suddenly, you know, help our high rents. Traffic congestion, and the loss of small independent retail space downtown in the Queen Street West area. So is Kingston's greatest assets its small town feel? How important is the downtown character to our tourism industry and the success of independent retailers? And are we about to kind of throw it away? Let me say a few words about the official plan now. And I think maybe I'm repeating myself, so if you're cutting me off, you're cutting me off. The city's 2010 official plan was written over several years based on the advice of numerous professional consultants and city staff. There was extensive public input sought and given by a very engaged public. A lot of those ideas and visions are reflected in the plan, I would argue. It was approved by the city and by the province. It is the blueprint to our city. It lays out the rules for everyone. What is the justification for overturning the official plan, for allowing exceptions to the rules for everyone, to the rules everyone is supposed to follow? Why ignore a good plan? Why should the city make a whole range of exceptions from ground floor commercial to bicycle parking to play areas to height, etc., and exclude Homestead from so many official plan and zoning requirements? Why overwrite the official plan? What does the city, what do we as a community gain from amending the plan and zoning in all these ways? And I would conclude that the application is lacking in convincing justification to overturn the official plan. And let me just add, kind of quickly, I guess, sorry. The merit of the application in front of us is to be judged on the current official plan, and while the plan might have some shortcomings, it obviously lays out some good guidelines and rules for development downtown, rules that would prevent such an application to be approved as is. We are here because Homestead is asking the city for an amendment of the plan. In other words, it is asking us to ignore the rules that we have established as a community and that reflects the kind of development we would like to see. This proposal does not reflect that vision and should not get approval. Thank you for your time.
Hi, my name is Mary Louise Adams. I'm a resident of Chestnut Street, which is in the Fruit Belt neighborhood just outside the downtown. So I actually think of myself as a downtown resident because my definition of the downtown stretches out beyond the main business streets. A number of the points I wanted to make have already been made, but I want to underline what the previous speaker just said. It's very clear why business people would be in support of this proposal, but the downtown is not just a place of business. It's the place where many of us live and make our exchanges and interchanges with other citizens in our city, and we need to remember that. Common sense notions and common sense assumptions. We saw this coming up a lot when we had the discussions around the K-Rock Center, and the assumption that simply bringing people into the downtown will increase business. We don't, in fact, know that. As the another speaker said earlier, the fact that we have, four new buildings, we have the new buildings at Block D, with a hotel on it as well. There was that little cafe in the bottom one, those buildings couldn't even stay open. Clearly, there were lots of residents there who could have used that cafe. Energy efficiency in high-rise buildings, sometimes it's better, sometimes it's not better. It depends on how they're built, of course. We can't just make blanket assumptions while we're making arguments about such a huge change to the city and such a huge project. Main point I want to make, though, is about the definition of intensification that's used in this proposal, and it's basically throw a bunch more people in the downtown. Intensification is not simply about increasing the number of residents in an area. It's about densifying also the kinds of activities that are done in that area. And if your developments don't actually encourage an increase of activity or a complication or complexity of activity, you have missed the benefits that you get from densification. So why bother doing it from the city's perspective in general? And it seemed like here we are hours into a planning meeting and nobody has mentioned either Richard Florida or Jane Jacobs. Let me fix that. Both too frequently quoted, but they do say some smart things. Density is good, but sometimes density goes too far. It's only good to a point. Florida writes, when buildings become so massive that street life disappears, we risk creating the same isolation that is more commonly associated with sprawl. Jacobs argues the same thing when she says that in the absence of pedestrian scale, density is trouble. Some urban planners now are arguing for a kind of measure of the value of an intensification project, not just the number of people that it throws down on a particular piece of land, but the kinds of activities that development can promote, that would be a measure of whether it was a valuable densification project or not. The massive towers that are going to dwarf the surrounding areas that are with a developer who's asking for relief from the ground floor commercial space and the things that were just noted around the other kinds of outdoor amenities is really going to fail on that measure of complicating the kinds of activities, bringing the vibrancy and the animation to the streets in the downtown area. And we risk turning Kingston then if this does set a precedent, as many people fear, and to increase it, to not just be this, it's not like we're just thinking about these two towers and maybe that one further up the street. We're thinking about towers in general in the downtown area. And what we risk there, as I think both of those two overquoted planners would say, is turning Kingston, which is unique, has something attractive that brings people into downtown businesses as a different kind of downtown. We risk turning Kingston into just another kind of mediocre mid-sized city that looks like all the other mediocre mid-sized cities. And so it's, to be trite and use a cliche, it's the killing the goose that laid the golden egg sort of thing. Thank you.
I've been reminded by our city clerk that we have to have a motion to extend past 11 o'clock. Councillor Neal, so moved, and to finish the agenda, to have everyone speak who is here.
Exactly, to complete the agenda.
Okay, seconded by Councillor McLaren. All those in favor? One opposed? That's carried. Thank you. So we'll continue. Someone on this side? Yep.
Yes.
There you go.
Okay, okay, sorry. I'm Ron Tosker. I live at 149 Earl Street. I've lived in Kingston for more than 30 years. Someone before said that fear of the unknown is some of the drives the opposition for these buildings, but I actually grew up in Toronto, and I can tell you it's not an unknown. Tall buildings create deserts around them. It's not a coincidence that in Toronto, the only vibrant areas are well removed from the tall buildings. If you look at this project in general, these buildings are massive. Even on Toronto scales, they're big. And we're trying to put them into a 200-year-old city, the most historic city in Ontario, right next to the beginning of Ontario, which is Fort Frontenac. The heritage impact study that was submitted by the developer does nothing to look at how this city is going to look from all around. And most importantly, I would say that would be the LaSalle Causeway, Fort Henry, Berryfield, then other views from various parts of the city. I mean, these are a huge impact on the city, and we already have a plan that's supposed to regulate this. So it seems like we're discarding the plan in the interest of economic interests, which is, of course, something that you might do, except it's being done without study. I don't see that all the dots have been joined in this matter. This is probably not the place where that discussion should be happening, and I would guess that the plan was structured in order to address those economic issues, and yet we're throwing out parts of it and keeping other parts of it. So I think to talk about economics is not really what this is about in terms of trying to give amendments to the zoning restrictions. I think the real issue here is, do we want these big buildings to be located a block from Fort Frontenac, right next to the old S&R building, and despite the impact study suggesting that it has no impact on the S&R building, that is one of the dominant buildings on Princess Street. You can't say 20-story building right next to it will not affect it. Of course it does. So, at any rate, thanks.
Hi there, I'm Matthew McCartney, and I live at 303 Montreal Street. Just sort of like a quick disclosure, I apologize for any amateur terminology, just kind of like new to this stuff, but I do have a very real like stake in it as I'm a new property owner and a proprietor of a new business in Kingston. So I have a mix of questions and sort of statements, and they're going to come together blocked under different things. And so I do want to say that I am a proponent of intensification. Like, as you can see, I'm kind of younger. I think I'm one of the younger speakers here. And so I definitely have a stake in future generations, and I feel somewhat being here, like I should be somewhat of a steward for that sort of thing. And so on that notion, I am quite concerned about the long-term ramifications of these sorts of developments and what they could pose on future generations, whether that comes in sort of an infrastructure burden, because like there hasn't really been any provisions about how that's going to be addressed, and so on. And anyways, moving forward, I think what I see the most problems with is sort of zoning things. And, you know, speaking to Mr. Tasker, who just left, he's talking about in Toronto, these developments, they go in, the large structures and so on. And a good example would be Liberty Village, like, is a new development that was planned. But recently I read an article in the Toronto Star, I'm sorry I don't have it for reference, that they're running into quite a problem where the people have been living there for the last 8 to 10 years. Now all of a sudden have families, and they're trying to either retrofit their condos to fit like four people, or they're looking elsewhere because they don't have the necessities like the infrastructure in place, schools, and you know there's not even really great medical facilities nearby. So that's kind of a problem, and I was wondering how that would be addressed. You know, anyways, as we're looking to close the downtown high school too. And I think that, you know, I generally like to look for solutions in policy and procedure before sort of just going all at it, you know, bricks and mortar style. And I think that there's a lot of potential for solutions in policy. You know, one of them saying there was an issue as far as retail on the main level. I think that if you look, you know, and this is just me speaking, like I said, amateur. I pay like a handsome amount of tax for the small piece of property that I do own. And I don't think it accurately reflects the potential for income earning for the city. when you look at it compared to sort of like an edge suburban development, because the density is much greater and the potential for business is much greater in my neighborhood than it might be in another more sprawled neighborhood. So I think like that's a good example of how that could be addressed. And, you know, maybe a redistribution and a restructuring of the municipal taxes. I know it's like pretty crazy, but, you know, that might be a solution that promotes downtown development. It makes it not $12 a square foot for retail space. You might make it $8 or $6. That would be great. But I also did see $4 a square foot on King Street the other day. So, yeah, and I think that another thing to be said for that is to procedural changes is that these solutions, and this is more addressed to the planning committee, procedural and policy changes could be more beneficial than just looking for height. Could be, you know, infill projects in Inner Harbor. I mean, I'm a stakeholder there, so I'm a little biased, but I disclosed that already. And and I think those are a lot more viable. We already saw a photo of the Baggett and Charles Street properties. Like, that's, you know, maybe a six-story development there is much more appropriate and a much better scale that I think is healthy for people and the occupants of the building and the adjacent buildings. And so I think those sorts of things are really good. But and then I did want to address the planners and the building owners. I'm aware of this one example where in LA they built the Walt Disney Performing Arts Center. And it's like it's one of Frank Gehry's buildings. Anyways, they ran into a serious problem where the parking was actually like tied physically on the other side of the street. And so the people would just come downtown LA, go to the theater, walk underneath the street, go and then watch the show, come back into their car and leave. And so I just see that as being a potential problem. I don't know whether it be in procedural or in the physical structure that is the parquet. Like, are they tied directly to, or do people have to come out the building and go in to get their car? Are they exposing them to all the potential retail space? Because that's what we want. That's what I heard as people have left. But anyways, those sorts of things, like, you know, I think they need to be addressed. And I think they're very important because, like, although they're really small and minute, those are serious things. Because if the people are just coming downtown that work out in the West End at some of the industrial parks and so on, they might drive downtown, get in the elevator in the parquet, go to their apartment block, and then come back down in the morning and go out to their car. And, you know, that sort of stuff I see as being a potential problem. But like I said, with policy and procedural things, you could scoot around it. Anyways, thank you.
Thank you. You may be the last speaker. Are there still people in Memorial Hall? Yes. Oh, if there is anyone in Memorial Hall, please come in and speak. No? Hi, Mary.
Am I on? Okay. I hadn't really planned on speaking tonight, but now we've had 24 speakers, and it's been so interesting hearing all the different perspectives and the divisiveness that has been created by this application and the capital application, and especially paying attention to Gavin Anderson and Tim Soper and what they said. And my feeling at this point is that this resembles the Wellington Street Extension issue, and I'm wondering about the possibility of a secondary plan for the downtown where we can actually come together as a city, as citizens, as developers, as people interested in our wonderful city, and have a real public outreach and discussion, much more than just one night like this. So I'm throwing that out. The city has done so well with the idea of a secondary plan for the old industrial area and the Inner Harbor area. The city has done so well with the waterfront master plan. And here's another one. Let's really have a vision together about how we imagine our downtown and harbor area. Thank you.
Thank you.
I didn't say my name, Mary Farrar, 1 Plastarm.
Go ahead.
Thanks very much for the opportunity. I don't have much to say, but my name is
Could
Mariah.
Could we get your name and address, sorry, please?
Mariah Hamilton. I live at 95 Queen Street. So I've heard a few people say they live downtown, but I live right there. And I live downtown, I work downtown, I spend a considerable amount of money downtown shopping, buying groceries, just in every part of my life. And that corner is an area of transition, which I think people don't really realize. Like every morning, I walk out, I go to Good Life, I go to the butcher, the dry cleaner is right there, Martello Alley. It's very, very vibrant, but it's also a little sketchy. The methadone clinic is still there. There's some people hanging around. And in my, in my parking where I am, it's not particularly safe. I live in a beautiful heritage townhouse that, as one gentleman said previously, is not sustainable. So I love living downtown. I looked at 13 places before I found one. And I'm most likely going to move out of downtown soon because I don't have a safe parking spot. I don't have good property management. I'm a single woman, and I would like to be in a high-rise. And it's not available. If you look on Ontario Street, just about every one of those buildings has very long waiting lists. So what I'm saying is there's a lack of availability. There are some beautiful new apartments above retail. I don't want to live above retail. I want to be in a safe, secure building with good property management. So I'm very much in support of this application. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Kurt Kahn. I live pretty close, 236 Wellington Street. So essentially this would be right across the street from my house, which is a commercial property. I have a business in the ground floor apartment. And this is a significant situation for us. One of the things that we're kind of intimately connected with is that flow of retail space, and the developers were very interestingly proposing an evolutionary kind of concept about that space, which I thought was really, really interesting, but it didn't really address what the criteria would be for the shift in usage of that space, which I thought what I would really have liked to see, because he said, I believe anyway, that it would have been not retail until the need warranted it. And my question would be, what would those needs be? Who would address them? And who would make those decisions as to when it would shift from whatever use it was to a full retail usage. And the other thing is I don't know enough about the history of it, is the brownfield condition that would prevent any kind of subterranean development. Is that strictly a cost measure? Is there a way to actually address that by, applying the funds that would clean up that area and allow for something to be used under the ground? And that's it for us. Thanks.
Next up will be the proponents, who will try to answer some of these questions and concerns. There were quite a few raised, but I think many you could summarize. I know Mr. Toe's done this a few times. You did get a number of issues raised. I hope you've written them all down.
First off, I want to thank everybody coming out. Whether you're still here or thank you for your time and your interest in Kingston. So many people care about the beauty in downtown. My wife and I do as well as so
amendments and zoning bylaw amendments, and why are they happening, or how can they happen? Why would you change an official plan that was, you know, years in the making and many thousands of dollars spent on it? So not to bore you with Planning Act details or anything, but so planning documents are meant to be 20-year documents, and the province mandates that every 5 years municipalities have to update them, because they recognize that municipalities change, the province changes. There are many factors that could cause or require that an official plan be updated for various reasons. So the province, right from the start through the Planning Act, requires that municipalities continuously update their official plan because of this. The Planning Act also explicitly permits amendments to official plans by private landowners, by the municipality, and also amendments to the zoning bylaw, so through various sections of the Planning Act, which is what the three meetings before ours tonight were about. They're about amendments to the zoning bylaw for various reasons. So there is a process that landowners go through to amend the planning documents of the municipality, and there's various reasons for that. And with respect specifically to this application, the official plan has policies about maximum building heights, and that's probably the main question many people had tonight, revolves around that at least. And the policies of the official plan, as were pointed out by ourselves and others, are that there is a maximum height, and there's also an allowance to go beyond that should certain tests be met. So yes, the official plan was created in 2009 based on a number of studies. One of the results of that was a maximum height limit with policies that allowed for more should certain tests be met. So that's why these applications have been filed, with supporting studies based on that policy and that premise. So that's why, you know, we're here before you tonight. And the way the process generally works is that these studies are done, the applications are put together and presented to the city, and then the public process is commenced through things like this. Certainly there's opportunity for additional public input, and this is a very robust process that every landowner has to go through when they file, whether it's somebody who's proposing to convert a two-unit dwelling to a three-unit dwelling, as we heard earlier tonight, or something of this nature. So trust that your representatives and planning committee members will help keep you informed, and we'll listen to your feedback, and we, as well as agents for the owners, will also listen to your feedback. And, you know, no project that gets presented in front of you today, very rarely is that the final end product, and we have no illusions that this is the final building that's going to be built. There's always going to be changes over the course of months between the application submission into when it's finally decided upon. So this is the start of a process, and we will work through this with staff and with members of the public as well. Just to keep informed as well, the city's recently, and plug for the city here, they've recently implemented a new electronic application system. So any information that we submit to the city in terms of public documents, reports, studies, et cetera, are all easily available online. So hopefully that will provide people with the information that they're looking for as much as possible. So we can keep you informed. There's questions about studies submitted and who should do them, or peer reviews, and I can tell you already that many such projects, including this one, there's a peer review done by an outside consultant for urban design and heritage. So although the proponent has hired a consultant to do those studies, they are going to be peer reviewed by an outside consultant to provide that review or independent review back to staff and to the city. With respect to shadowing, and I may answer this, and it would help if I could get the slideshow back. I'm not sure if that's possible, because I have some additional shadow sunshade images I could show. So I'm kind of locked out at the moment, but if I can get back in, I can show those. Just while that's happening. So when buildings are proposed, and certainly downtown buildings like this, part of the urban design study is looking at the impacts from that building, one of them obviously being shadowing, which Vicky Smolka obviously pointed out as a question, and many others as well. And so what we've done, or what the architect has done, is taken the existing building, and actually I may let Rod take over at this point because this is his slide, and he can kind of explain what you had done and what you're showing on the slides. So the way
we analyze as part of our report, we analyze the site in terms of what we're proposing and also in terms of the planned function, and we generally focus on the equinox and the solstice, so the high points and the low points. And we look at hours between 8 o'clock or 10 o'clock in the morning to 4 o'clock in the afternoon. And I'm not sure how the slide is here. Basically, this is looking at March 21st, showing the impact of the sun at the top left, 10 o'clock in the morning, 12 on the right side, and just basically it follows the sun. They're computer-generated shadows based on the model and putting in the information. And what's important is when we...
it's turned off.
Oh, it's turned off? Oh, sorry. Or can I just do it from this? Oh, I can do it from that. Yeah. We then look at sort of as a right, and then we do a comparison to see what the impact is between the two. And there was a gentleman who came up with a solar power, can you point on that solar. Exactly? Where the solar?
Yes, this is the Royal Bach building, which would be right here.
And I think we can demonstrate that we looked at this site, and we also looked at another adjacent site and demonstrated that there were no adverse impact on those roofs generated from this proposed development. Are you finished, or did you want
to? Yes, you want to go ahead.
Oh, can you just grab me? So I'm going to try to be short because it's been a long day. there's some easy questions I think I can answer fairly simply. We do study for earthquakes. The Ontario Building Code actually regulates earthquake zones and activities, and the buildings are designed to withstand. Ottawa, for example, has the highest earthquake zone in North America, I think, except for, I think, Vancouver. But it's a different type of earthquake than you see in LA. Our buildings are designed for that. In terms of energy efficiency, again, we use a very high standard of energy efficiency in both our modeling and our review of the design of the buildings. We generally don't rely on the LEEDs process, in my personal opinion. I'm not a big fan of LEEDs only because I find it's a very excellent promotional material on selling the LEEDs product, and it basically puts an undue cost associated with the monitoring of something that we're doing anyways as a result of trying to create better efficiently run projects. And I can say from, especially when you talk about a rental project where every cost is very important, and the long range goal of a rental project is to keep tenants, one of the best ways to do that is have very efficient units. And so it's inherent in the product is to create efficiency in the design. So, and that's done. But as I say, we generally don't work on the LEEDs principle unless so directed. We have increased green space along the city sidewalks. We have as a minimum provided at least a 5-meter sidewalk curb to building, and we try to increase that where possible. And along Queen Street, for example, we have areas within the trees with benches so people can sit and just relax for a bit. We've added sort of a green respite park-like area, a mini park area on Ontario Street, again, more of a visual respite, as well as a softening of the site. So we are interested in street landscaping, and we'll continue to develop the project and as we move forward. Solar shadow we talked about. Livability, and I really enjoyed the one of the last speakers talked about intensification. Doesn't just mean more people, it means intensifying activity, and I'm a great believer in that. But one of the best ways is bringing people down there to do just that. And then I would like to take a little bit of exception to one statement that high-rise buildings basically destroy neighborhoods, and intensification destroy neighborhoods. If anyone has been to places like Toronto or my city, Ottawa, and seen the changes in areas like the Byward Market in Toronto, I think at King Street West, areas that a few years ago were dead, absolutely nothing happening on the weekends, now are full of people, full of life, restaurants are opening up. Ottawa, the markets come to life again. Preston Street, there's talk about a grocery store going in because of all the increased population, where all the grocery stores in that whole area of the city abandoned it completely. So we have miles between grocery stores in this area, and now there's talk of them coming back into town. So these, this sort of intensification has some real positive spin-offs, and we hope to this would be a building that would generate that type of activity. Thank you.
I'd just like to, first of all, echo Mark Tal's comment about appreciating not only people who showed up and stayed late, but showed a passion for the city. I think Kingston will ultimately benefit from this every time. I've taken 15 pages of copious notes, and I only got 28 speakers, but maybe you found two while I was in the washroom or something. And I think it will warrant a more full response, but I just wanted to say that there was a number of erroneous statements made, which I think it was best to clarify through written response, and to assure those who question about one report that they thought that wasn't reviewed, that we'll double check that, and we reviewed a lot of reports, so I can't say for sure, but I've written that one down. I'm ready to come back with the written response on that. There's so many aspects to it. I think that the key heritage one that I'd like to make is that in a heritage impact assessment, the focus is on designated properties under the Ontario Heritage Act. The whole assessment report is an organ of the Ontario Heritage Act, so it's based on designations from the Ontario Heritage Act. Fort Frontenac, as significant and important as it is in our nation's history, is not designated under the Ontario Heritage Act. National Historic Site, and as such, and there are many of us who lament this, but as such does not have protection under provincial legislation, nor is there any federal legislation that protects it either. Whether you like that or not, and I don't, that is the framework under which we are working, and I just wanted to clarify that too, in case anyone walks away thinking that the Heritage Conservation Architects forgot about Fort Frontenac. I think it's late, Madam Chair. There's lots of response that I think great questions, great concerns that do warrant response. And I think if our client is in agreement, we'd be pleased to provide those responses. And the last point I would make is that many of the concerns that were expressed with respect to the urban design report and or the heritage impact assessment are covered under the recommended mitigating measures that are embedded into those reports. So many of our responses will refer to those.
And could I just ask where the public will be able to see those responses? Will this be through?
Yeah, I think that will have to be dealt with between staff and the proponent, and I can't answer that question.
But we'll make that available.
Thank you, Tria. You, Madam Chair, as Mr. Tao indicated, we have our new Dash Online system, so the document will be uploaded as part of the resubmission from the applicant and available through that. If there are people that don't have access through the internet or aren't comfortable using that system, they can contact our planning department and the planner, and we can provide that document.
And Councillor Neal, you had questions.
Yes, actually two of my points were covered with an acknowledgement that there will be an urban design review similar to the one that was done at the N8. So I look forward to that review. The other thing I'll very quickly say, with all due respect, planners are forever saying everything is site specific, it doesn't set precedent, and then they go on to point out comparators that favor the project. And I just want to point out that the North Harbor shown on the slide has no development of this scale, and what was referenced on the South Harbor, I believe it either entirely or substantially is outside the downtown and harbor area architectural guidelines. So the comparator, the only comparator I believe, is probably Anna Lane within that immediate area. So perhaps that's the comparator we should be looking towards, which is 9 stories. So thank you.
Thanks, Councillor. Just a very brief response to a portion of what you were just saying, and it's the thorny issue of precedent. Someone tonight, and I'm sorry, it was hours ago, I don't remember who, but quoted about, you know, there was a line in one of the reports saying, you know, you can't say that what's in this report sets precedent. They may have been quoting one section in the Heritage Impact Assessment, which we authored, so I'll respond in case it was that one. That is a section that we put in each and every time we do a Heritage Impact Assessment based on years of finding out afterwards, and sometimes years afterwards, that someone dug that up, that opinion up about that particular project on that particular site. And sometimes it's comparable and sometimes it's not. The problem is, you know, some less than knowledgeable people might decide that it's comparable when, for example, professional staff of the municipality might say, well, it's not comparable. So I think the danger is not necessarily in using precedents per se, it's using inappropriate precedents. And I think that's kind of creates a little bit of confusion, understandably, but I think hopefully staff in their thorough review of all of this will know which precedents are worthy of quoting and which ones are not, and they're only worthy if there's direct relationships.
Are there any other questions from the committee? Seeing none, I will close this public meeting, and thank you all very much for your patience and your involvement in the city. We do have a regular meeting of planning. However, under approval of the agenda, the business item is to be withdrawn. So could I have approval of the agenda as amended?
Councillor O'Sanic, Councillor Turner, all those in favor? And the minutes of the planning meeting, February 4th. Mover and seconder, Councillor Neal, Councillor Adam. Alan, I don't know. It's really late. I was going to call you Richard Adams after the author. Any errors or omissions? All those in favor? Thank you. Disclosures of pecuniary interest, delegations, briefings, and there is no business. No notice motions, notices of motions, other business, various pieces of correspondence, and I believe motion to adjourn. Date of the next meeting, March the 3rd. Councillor Allen, Councillor Turner, seconds. All those in favor. Thank you. Yes, it was. The business portion.